Thanks, Dr. Chitra, and it's a privilege to be in your course. I will be showing a few cases, and I'll trouble the panel also with few questions in between so that we can have a better discussion. So refractive surgery is all about good decision making, and I think doing the surgery itself is of course necessary that you do a good job, but knowing which procedure to choose, when to say no, when to say a conditional yes, how much to treat, how much residual stromal bed is safe. I mean, there are so many things which go into being a good refractive surgeon that it requires years of experience with refractive surgery to actually understand. And, you know, we are learning almost every day, even 15, 20 years after doing refractive surgery, I think I still continue to learn. So let's discuss a few cases. I thought it'll be more interesting to do a, you know, case-based discussion. And this gentleman, 24 years old male with a small correction, minus 1.5 with 0.5 at 20 degrees and 2.25 and 0.5 at 170 degrees, improving to a crisp 6x6 and wants refractive surgery. This is what the pentachem maps look like. Now, if you'll notice, there is a skew in the axes, which is a bit of a flag. And if you'll see the elevation maps and the pachymetry is small, it's about 460. And if you'll notice the other eye, that's 464, similar skew. So otherwise, straightforward refraction, and patient is keen to go with the surgery. And this is the enhanced ectasia display, which looks fairly good, except that the percentage thickness increase is dipping as it is in the other eye. So this is the other eye. So essentially, we have to decide whether we are going to offer him a refractive surgery at all. He's had a stable correction for almost 3 years and has had no change in refraction, and is having case of this degree. I think I'll start with Dr. Ramamurthy. Would you offer him a refractive surgery at all? If he's quite insistent that he wants something.
I would go ahead and do refractive surgery in him. 24 years, if no family history of keratectasia, quite a stable power and a small power. I do a PRK, and in case, because I saw that the overall D in one of the eyes is yellow, and also there's a mild skewing, and the it's less than 470. So I do a PRK Xtra in him. Okay. I mean, Xtra may not be necessary, but just as a matter of additional safety, I would like to do a PRK Xtra, and I think he'd do well.
Perfect. Anybody else would differ? I mean, do something different? If you're doing the same thing, then let's go ahead. All of you want to do the same thing, is it? Shri Ganesh, you want to do something different? It'll be good to have his view. Let him tell.
460, yeah. You
Yeah, 460.
Refractive 455 is very small, and 1.5.
Yeah, 1.5.
So you can do a smile extra because the residual.
Vis-a-vis PRK, how would smile do better? Or
if you're doing a smile extra, then I think both probably I feel would have the similar result.
Okay.
But the pain factor, because in a smile extra, you're not removing the epithelium.
Right.
You're injecting the dye in the interface, and then.
What thickness of cap would you use for this patient?
120.
120?
120.
Okay.
But so still, you would have a residual bed of 300.
Okay. Anybody would like to differ? I mean, Dr. Mahipal, would you differ? He's busy. So anyway, let's. So I think I would have done a surface, but Shri Ganesh is more confident about smile. I know that he has much more experience than us.
Question of whether both the biomechanical stability, which is better.
Right.
I think most of us still believe that PRK is biomechanically a little more stable than smile. Of course, smile is possible, but maybe that's the reason some of us would offer this.
Right, sir. All the same, you know, for the benefit of the audience, I would think that yes, these are possibilities, but your first instinct should be to refuse this patient surgery and, you know, keep him on follow-up. So the take-home message should not be that you jump and do a PRK or a smile on this patient. Personally, I would have, if patient was okay with it, I would have put him on follow-up for at least an year or two on pentacams, refractions, everything, corneal thickness, and mapped him for a couple of years and be sure that he's got a stable cornea. So on first instance, probably might not treat it, but I would be okay doing surface for this patient subsequently. Just a question, would anybody do smile on the ICL on this patient? He has a very good AC depth. Would anybody want to do an ICL? I don't even know if they are available in this bar, but there are some people who don't do LASIK at all and they do only phakic lens. So anybody who would do ICL? No. Okay. So let's go to this next case. I would also do a surface extra, as you said. Now this girl, 22 years old. Now, this was very peculiar. Just came to me about 2 weeks back, and she had been worked up for LASIK at another center. And then one of my previous patients said that, sir, she's undergoing surgery tomorrow, and I've motivated her to come to you. So I said, you know, why don't you go ahead? She said, no, I mean, I want you to do it for her. I said, okay, you bring her along. They showed me all the maps and scans and everything, and they looked good. So I called them over. Now, this is what it looked like. She had K's which were in the 43s and 44s. And a good corneal thickness, 557, 562. And this is what the anterior and posterior elevation maps and the four maps look like for the left eye, for the right eye. Now, she has a correction of minus 7 with 0.5 cylinder. Dr. Chitra, would you go ahead and operate this patient?
You shouldn't show the bellend.
Yeah, that's where. So, where she was worked up, there was no provision for a bellend ambrosio map. So I had only these maps to go by.
No, see, your AC depth is only 2.56.
Yeah.
So you can't do an ICL.
Right.
Okay. And what's her age? I missed out.
So she was, let me check. She was 22. And she has a stable refraction for 5 years. That was the amazing thing.
I wouldn't mind doing a smile for this patient. But again, the Bellin, I would have loved to see. Present day, we should look at the Bellin and take a call.
Yeah, so we had these maps, but we did not have the Bellin Ambrosio when I saw these maps. Yeah. So we went ahead and, you know, worked her up, and we did the pentacam ourselves, and this is what came out. Now, if you look at these maps, you know, you'll see this, you know, on the posterior maps, you'll see this.
The final overall D is within normal limits.
Yeah, it is. So, and this is the fellow eye. So what we did was, she was a contact lens user. She'd been off for almost 10 days. We've asked her to stay off lenses, and we repeated the pentacam after about a week of a total of about 20 days off contacts, but the maps did not change at all. So for the time, okay, what would
just
you
comment,
do?
See, in patients with more prolate cornea, you can see this. So the corneas are normal, but slightly more
they
prolate, you can have a little increase in the anterior elevation and also a little in the posterior elevation, but still within, I mean, it's borderline.
Yeah.
And if you look at the final D, it's okay. So I think you should go more by the curvature and the skew deviation, infrasuperior steepening. These are signs. Which
all those things look good, actually.
Yeah, they are all
so
normal. So
would you go ahead with a smile, or
yes,
or would you do an extra smile? Or
no, just go
just
ahead with
a smile.
Smile? Because, yeah, just a smile.
Okay.
Because the thickness is good.
Great. Let's quickly come on to one more patient. And this girl, minus 3 with a half cylinder and minus 3.25 with 0.75 cylinder, stable refraction for 3 years, 27 years old. Now, she had come to us about 4 or 5 years back, and this is what the maps looked like at that time. And she underwent a surface ablation because she was not fit for an ICL. Now, these maps are not really good, but this patient had to have a refractive surgery of some kind. She had been following up with us for 2 years, and she had had stable maps for almost 2 years. There was this inferior steepening, and frankly, when we did this case about 4 or 5 years back, we did not have the Bellin Ambrosio display on our pentacam. So we had just to go up with this, and she came for a follow-up last week. That's how I pulled out her maps. So we had done a surface treatment with a surface Xtra in 2014 January or something. Now, this is what, in retrospect, we then took out her pentacam data, and this is what it looked like when we put it on the Bellin Ambrosio maps for the one eye and for the other eye. And now with the post-op data is like this. Today she looks like this. There's a surface treatment which was done. This is the pachymetry map. And if you do a subtraction map, we have three datas on record. This was the pre-op with the inferior steepening. This was done about 2015, 1 year later. And you can see the flattening continues to happen even now in 2018. She's doing pretty well. Her you know, refraction has remained very stable, and she's about 0.25 hyperope in one eye, and in the other eye, this is the situation. And again, a skew and an inferior steepening to some extent, and continued flattening even after 4 years. So I think surface Xtra works really well as a good option for refractive surgery, and gives very good stable refractive results. And this case, I thought I will share with you because it's in retrospect also, that you know, it had uneasy maps. And so I think if I've run out of time, I'll stop here. I had a few more cases, but I think we are out of
time.
Thanks.
Just had an inferior steepening on the curvature map, So probably we would have been, would have wanted to see the balance or
I know. So
take
the
her
funny
off
thing
contact
is
lenses, it could be a temporary thing.
I know.
I think you've been lucky doing
so, so. Exactly. So 5 years back, we did not have Bellin Ambrosi on our systems. True. So this was only in retrospect that, you know, now we had the data imported into our new system and we decided to do a surface Xtra at that time. And that has probably helped us, you know, have a stable cornea and not gone on to anything. So I wanted to highlight that when in doubt on a suspicious cornea, it's a good option to do a, you know, cross linking along with the surface treatments, and that gives you added level of safety as well.
And even during retreatments, doing a cross linking, as Dr. Gaurav said, makes a lot of sense. Thanks a lot, Gaurav. In the short while, you put up some interesting cases.